Good morning. Good morning. Well, it's been a great morning already. Boy, those baptisms were powerful. What a strong testimony. And I'm excited about this sermon today. I want you to imagine that 10 minutes ago, maybe you went to one of our preschool rooms around here, and you just kind of observed and saw different things that were taking place. Now, if you did that, it's likely that you may have seen a little boy taking a plastic car and running around the carpet going vroom, vroom, vroom. Or maybe you see a four-year-old girl holding onto a doll and just singing to her heart's content to that doll. Or maybe you'd see another three-year-old boy over here holding on to a box of crayons and screaming out, mine, mine. Now, those things wouldn't throw us off at all if that's what we experienced. But change the location, and if you came in here just a few minutes ago and you walked into this sanctuary at any of our campuses, and you would have seen one of the ushers running around with a small plastic car going vroom, vroom, or one of the vertical worship singers up here singing to a doll, or Tommy Kreitz going around yelling, mine, mine, holding crayons. Maybe that's a bad example. My point is, when you see something like that, you would immediately say, you know what, somewhere along the line, they kind of missed out on the maturing process, didn't they? There's something missing. And what we excuse in a child, we dislike in an adult. For growth to take place, there has to be deepening. There has to be maturing. And when normal growth doesn't occur in anything, whether it's a person, a plant, an organization, it's a sign that it's not healthy. Our message this week is entitled, Get Growing. And last week, we continued our walk through the Gospel of Mark, and we were in Mark chapter 4, and we learned about Jesus Christ's very first parable. It was the one about the sower and the seed and the soil, and the different responses and reactions that people have to the Word of God or to the seed. And this weekend, here's what I want you to come and see. I want you to come and see how God's involvement can turn small beginnings into something that is quite significant. We've seen Him do that. We've seen Him do that in our own lives. We've seen Him do that in the life of the church. And we know that He can continue to do that. So look in your Bible at Mark chapter 4. We're going to begin with verse 21. We're going to walk our way through this text. And Jesus said to them, is a lamp brought in to be put under a basket or under a bed and not on a stand? And we'll stop right there. There's an interesting insight in the Greek language that we sometimes miss in the translation of this verse. It doesn't really show up in the English, but the first phrase indicates that Jesus is expecting a negative answer to this rhetorical question. When he says, no one lights a lamp to hide it. So he's expecting everybody to say, no one would do that. And conversely, the next question, and not place it on a stand. It, in the original language, is expecting the affirmative answer. Of course, you would put it on a stand where it can do its best work. That's where a lamp serves its purpose. Three lessons, three challenges today. Here's the first one. Shine your light. Shine your light. Jesus is the light of the world, the Bible tells us. Jesus himself tells us that. He also says, you are the light of the world. So we are to be a reflection, a representation of his light. And in your own mind, your light may seem rather insignificant, but don't underestimate how he can illuminate a dark setting through you, how he can use your testimony, how he can use your witness. Think of it like this. Back in the ancient world, light was very important, as you could imagine, prior to electricity. You had to be quite strategic about where you put the lamp in order to get the maximum benefits out of it. But back then, a lamp was so important. It was a small, round, ceramic lamp with a short, flaring nozzle that came out of it. And wicks were stuck out of the nozzle, and the olive oil would be placed in that small container, and it would be enough olive oil that it would burn all night. But the wife typically had to get up once or twice through the night to adjust the wick so that there would be continued light in the morning that they could then use that light to start like a pilot light for the fire in their home to warm the place up in the morning. You say, well, okay, Dave, what makes you think that the woman had to get up in the middle of the night and do that? I know you're wondering that, right? Well, I'll tell you why I think that. Because in Proverbs chapter 31, where it talks about the virtuous woman, it says this in verse 18. She sees that her trading is profitable and her lamp does not go out at night. So the virtuous woman has all these different tasks and things that she does and who she is with her character. And Solomon includes that in the list, that was something that a good wife was kind of in charge of. Some commentators point out that generally speaking, Middle Easterners back then feared the dark. And so that small, shining, flickering light represented abundant life, joy, peace, which it makes it easier for us to make the application. Because you see, in this paragraph in Mark chapter 4, what Jesus is saying is when he talks about the light or the lamp, he's actually speaking about himself. He's talking about his teaching. And he and his teaching bring abundant life and joy and peace. That's what Jesus does. So if you truly are following him and you want to see his kingdom come, then you, in turn, will want to shine your light. Now, some of these terms that we'll find throughout the parables that Jesus tells, they're kind of mysterious analogies for us to try to figure out. But we realize that there is coming a day when the whole world will come to believe who Jesus is. And when Christ returns, God will remove that veil, and the king and the kingdom will be seen fully and will be seen clearly by all. Look back in your Bible at Mark chapter 4, verse 22. For nothing is hidden except to be made manifest, nor is anything secret except to come to light. Jesus says it wouldn't make sense to hide a light, now would it? And those things that you do try to hide will eventually be brought out into the light. And so save yourself the trouble, Jesus is saying. Save yourself the time and energy and come clean early. Jesus' words, nor is anything secret except to come to light, is trying to drive us toward living a life that is open, that is vulnerable, that is transparent. And you will get healthy sooner if you don't have to always live out of fear of being found out. If you're familiar with any 12-step programs or recovery programs or counseling ministries, you know that there is a common phrase that is often said, and that's this: you're only as sick as your secrets. And there's truth in that. And while some Christians keep their struggles and their weaknesses a secret, other Christians struggle with something else. You know what it is for them? They want to keep their faith a secret. They want to keep that close to the vest. They want to feel comfortable when they are at their boss's raunchy holiday party, but they also want to feel comfortable when they're talking with their Christian friends after a church service. And Jesus is saying you can't have it both ways. You've got to dive in to this faith stuff. You've got to be in all the way. But some Christians are hesitant to let others know of their commitment to Jesus. They don't want to rock the boat. They don't want to open themselves up for ridicule. It's all in how you look at things. But if your goal in this life is to have a conflict-free existence, where you simply blend in with everyone, if your plan is to pursue pleasure and peace and prosperity, then all you need to do is follow the crowd. But Jesus Christ didn't die for you to blend in. Jesus Christ died for you to stand out, for you to be distinctive, for you to be different. What's the purpose of the church if we are no different than the rest of the world? And so we must shine our light. And if you want to change the world for Christ, and I'm here to tell you that there's no better time in the history of all civilization for you to shine your light, to be able to have more of an impact on behalf of Christ. In Philippians chapter 2, verses 15 and 16, the Apostle Paul is talking there, and he says that you may be blameless and innocent, children of God, without blemish, in the midst of a crooked and twisted generation, among whom you shine as lights in the world, holding fast to the word of life. This is a tremendous opportunity in the midst of this season of multiculturalism, in the midst of this season of moral freefall, in the midst of this season of political polarization. This is the time for Christ followers to share the light and shine the light of Jesus Christ, because the darker the background, the brighter the light. And as this world becomes increasingly more and more dark, the hope of the gospel of Jesus Christ shines that much more brightly. Look back in your Bible at verses 23 through 25. And Jesus says, "If anyone has ears to hear, let him hear." And he said to them, "Pay attention to what you hear. With the measure you use, it will be measured to you, and still more will be added to you. For to the one who has, more will be given, and from the one who has not, even what he has will be taken away." Now, what's he talking about here? Well, it sounds like he's talking about money, but he's really not talking about money or possessions. He's not even talking about finances. He's referring to understanding the message of the kingdom of heaven. That's at the heart of all of these parables. And last week we learned that there is an expectation for the hearer of the word. And upon hearing the word of God, you have a decision that you have to make. The question is, how will you respond? Every time I hear God's word, I have to think, how will I respond to this? Every time I read God's word, I have to think, what will my decision be? Every time I preach God's word, I'm hearing God's word again and again. I've got to ask myself, okay, that's what the Bible says. Now, what are you going to do about it? Will you go for it? Will you dive in? How will you respond? And to the person whose heart is closed to spiritual matters, then God won't bless that understanding. And so they'll continue to be confused and won't understand things. You are going to get out of it what you put into it. And for the one who has that desire for understanding, God is going to give more and more understanding to you. Maybe this will help you understand. My daughter, Sadie, is pretty athletic. And when she was in high school, one time she decided to play another sport because some of her friends were playing field hockey. Well, I thought, okay, well, you know, knock yourself out, go for it. And we started going to her field hockey games, and I feel like I understand sports pretty well. But while I'm watching these field hockey games, I don't have a clue what's going on. And all of a sudden, they're going downfield, and the whistle blows, and everybody stops, and the referee does some motions and does something. They start going the other direction. And all the parents were like, well, what is going on? What's going on? They just didn't have a clue what it was. But there was one dad, his daughter had played field hockey for a number of years. And he said the first year that he started going to field hockey games, he said, I was clueless. He said, I had no idea what was going on. But he said the second year when I realized she was going to stick with it, he said, I started learning about it, and I started studying it. I started to understand the game. So now, every time that the whistle would blow, every parent in the bleachers, we would turn and we would look at that guy. And that guy would look at all of us, and he would give us the explanation, and we'd go, oh, okay, and then we'd go back to it, right? Maybe that's what it's like for you when it comes to spiritual matters, and you just haven't been hungry enough to pour yourself into your faith. Maybe you just haven't said, okay, Lord, will you help my understanding? Or as James talks about, Lord, will you give me wisdom? Because I'm asking of you, and you're the God who gives it generously. And so we ask for his understanding. What was it that God said back in Jeremiah chapter 29, verse 13? He said, you will seek me and find me when you seek me with all of your heart. With all of your heart. Not a passing glance, not just a fading hobby, but with all of your heart. And Jesus is saying in this parable, if you dive headlong into following me, these mysteries of the kingdom of God will make more sense to you and you will have more clarity about them. Professor Mark Strauss explains it this way. He says, to those who are responsive to Jesus' kingdom teaching, the parables provide even greater spiritual insight. But for the hard-hearted outsiders who reject the message, their spiritual blindness will only increase. That's a reference to the Pharisees and the religious leaders that Jesus had right there in his midst. But it also could be a reference to us if we're not careful. to be ever understanding but not perceiving. So the first challenge is to shine your light. Here's the second challenge. Show some trust. I mean, we just sang about how it is that Jesus is trustworthy. Will you give him your trust? Jesus is about to tell a parable, and this parable is sometimes referred to as the parable of the seed growing. Sometimes it's called the growing seed. Now, you have to understand that back then, Jesus isn't dividing up his talk. He's not passing out outlines. He's not saying, okay, get ready to fill in the blanks on these. This is just a freestyle teaching, and yet it will contain callbacks to previous teachings that he has given and also foreshadowing for the future of things that he will share. Look in your Bible at verse 26 through 29, and it's a very short parable that Jesus shares. And he said, the kingdom of God is as if a man should scatter seed on the ground. He sleeps and rises night and day, and the seed sprouts and grows. He knows not how. The earth produces by itself, first the blade, and then the ear, then the full grain in the ear. But when the grain is ripe at once, he puts in the sickle because the harvest has come. Here it is again. We talked about this last weekend. The ultimate goal is to reap a harvest, a bountiful crop from the seeds that we have sown. And get this, this man plants a seed. Jesus says he sleeps and he rises, and the seed sprouts and grows. And Jesus is saying the guy does nothing. The guy didn't do anything but throw some seed down. And yet somehow it grows. And I love that phrase that Jesus says. He knows not how. No understanding. No explanation. Farmer in the first century can't explain the process of what is going on. Farmer's wiser than most of us. We think that sometimes things happen because of us. Because of our wisdom. Because of our position. Because of our prestige, because of our talent. And it's always dangerous whenever you think that you are higher than everyone else. Amen. Did you ever hear about the story, what happened to the Pope a few years ago? Somebody gave the Pope a brand spanking new limousine, sweetest vehicle you ever did see. Gold encased. He was going crazy over it. He said to his chauffeur, he said, you got to let me take this thing out for a spin. He said, oh no. He said, you have not driven a vehicle in so many years. That would not be wise. They argued back and forth. Finally, reluctantly, the chauffeur gave the Pope the keys and said, okay, take the limousine out, but please don't speed. Be very careful. Pope said, I'll be careful. He got going. He got so excited. He hadn't driven in so long. He was in this sweet ride. He was going 60 miles per hour in a 35 mile per hour zone. Illinois state trooper pulled him over. How many of y'all have ever met an Illinois state trooper? All right. Yes, I see that hand. Sure enough, state trooper came walking up to the side, and the Pope pushed a little electronic button, and the window started coming down, and he said, all right, buddy, what's the big hurt? He said, excuse me, Your Holiness. He said, would you wait right here? He said, I'm going to go back to my car, and I've got to radio my chief on this situation. He said, just stay right here. Went back to the squad car. He radioed to the chief. He said, chief, I got a real big problem. He said, I just pulled over a very important person. I know there's a mandatory fine. I know I got to give him a ticket, but I don't think I can give this guy a ticket. Chief said, well, is he more important than the president of Italy? He said, yeah, he's more important than the president of Italy. He said, is he more important than the president of Germany? He said, yeah, he's more important than the president of Germany. He said, is he more important than the president of the United States? He said, yeah, he's more important than the president of the United States. Chief said, well, who is he? Trooper said, I don't know. He said, what do you mean you don't know? He said, well, I don't know who he is, but his chauffeur is the Pope. We're getting deep this morning. It really doesn't make any difference whether you are the chauffeur or you are the one being chauffeured, as long as you realize this, there is one who is so much more important than any of us. He is the one who makes a seed grow. He is the one who makes the tree bear fruit. That's why we sing, you have no rival. You have no equal. He is above all things. His name is Jesus. There's no logical explanation for a seed being dropped on ground to suddenly sprout and grow. There's no logical explanation other than the part that God brings to the table. And of course, that's the most important part in the process. Growth. How does that happen? Only God can explain it. We have a friend named Hannah. She lives in Nashville, and she was telling Beth and me about a recent flight that she was on. We actually called her yesterday just to make certain that we had the details of this story accurate. And she talked about how before she got on this airplane, she had been praying, okay, Lord, how do you want to use me? How can you use me to maybe speak to someone or to encourage someone? And she got on this plane, and she felt like the Lord was impressing on her that she was supposed to talk to the person that was beside her and share with them. Well, there's nobody seated beside her. But the last person to come walking in was a young gal with bright blue hair. And when she came, she sat down right next to her, and she was very closed off, and you could tell that she didn't want anybody talking to her. And Hannah thought, oh no, this is a person, Lord, that you want me to talk to? But eventually, after a few minutes, she was obedient, and she just said, I am fascinated by your hair. I love the different colors that you have. Can you tell me about that? And the girl uncrossed her arms and began to share with her. And they started in a conversation, and the gal went on to tell Hannah her entire life story. And she just kept talking, and Hannah learned that she was going through a divorce right then. And she has a 4-year-old, and she said, I'm on this trip to try to figure out where it is that we're supposed to live, and I should, whether or not I should ask my parents if I can come back home to live with them. And she said, I don't know how they'll respond to that. There's been some problems in the past, and I don't know if they'll take me back. And Hannah said that she looked at her and said, well, God wants you just to have humility. God wants you to have a repentant spirit. And the whole time that they were talking, Hannah said she felt like God was just impressing upon her, bringing to her mind over and over again, say to her Jeremiah 29:11. Say Jeremiah 29:11. And she thought, oh no, that's a scripture verse that everybody says, and they use it out of context a lot. I don't want to say that. But she kept listening and talking, and finally she just gave up and said to the girl and said, you know what? God has plans for you. In the Bible, in Jeremiah chapter 29, verse 11, says God has plans for you to give you hope, to give you a future, plans to prosper you. And Hannah said when she said that verse to her, that the girl just began bawling. She just began crying. And Hannah didn't know what she had said and didn't know what was going on. And she said, I'm sorry if that bothered you. She said, oh, no. And she said, do you know that verse? And she said, yeah, I know it. She said, a godly relative of mine always quoted that verse to me at a very early age. But she said, what you don't know is that before I got on this flight today, I prayed to God that if he really was real and if he really was up there, that he would have somebody say to me directly, Jeremiah 29:11. And she said, and if that happened, then I knew that I was supposed to go back home. How does something like that happen? We know not how, but we do know who. We do know who. Who is responsible? And those things happen when God is honored, when seeds are planted, when prayers are offered, when the promptings of the Spirit are followed. God steps in and he brings growth. Seeds that were sown many, many years before. And the word of God that was faithfully sown by a godly relative, those seeds are still growing. And the farmer sows the seed, and he will be taught a lesson in patience because he can't give life to the seed. His job is just to sow it. The crop arrives in stages, first the blade and then the head and then the mature grain in the head. And the harvest is a result of God's intervention, not man's human effort. There's no such thing as a self-made woman, a self-made man. Because when we say that, what we are doing is we are taking God out of the equation. We can be so quick to reduce the role and downplay the divine and silence the significance of the part that God plays in the process of someone's success or someone's growth or of something taking place. He is the one who enables growth to take place. And yes, we have a part to play through our work ethic and through our obedience and through our limited knowledge, but just understand that your part is a supporting role. He is the one who gives the increase. He makes the difference when you put your trust totally in him and surrender. And if we are quick to take the credit and ignore him and want nothing to do with him, then in time he will do what any perfect gentleman will do. He will just walk away because his presence is not wanted. Don't make that mistake. Remember, Jesus says that even the limited understanding you have will be taken away. In other words, if you don't use something, you're going to lose something. Think of it like this. Spiritual neglect leads to spiritual atrophy. But it doesn't have to be that way, because the same one who causes the rains to fall and the sun to shine is the same one who causes a seed to sprout and grow. And he can do it whether that's a plant that produces a crop or whether it is a heart that is in need of transformation. So make certain that you consistently shine your light and acknowledge the one who is the giver of every good and perfect gift. And show your trust in him. Jesus gives us the game plan in John chapter 15, verse 5. You probably know this passage. Jesus says, I am the vine, you are the branches. If you remain in me and I in you, you will bear much fruit. But apart from me, you can do nothing. There are no self-made men or women, and Jesus makes that clear. Apart from me, you can do nothing. Our problem is that we want to compare how the seeds we've planted are growing more than someone else's crop. We love the comparison game. It doesn't matter what's taking place. We just love to compare. We've got it all figured out. The problem with comparisons is we want to make ourselves look better when it comes to our achievements, but when it comes to our journey and it comes to our plights and how we have to go through the rough times of life, we always want our plight to seem worse than others. So that way, any success that we experience or any significance that comes our way, well, somehow we get more of the credit if we do it that way. It's more like we had to overcome so much more. But can I tell you something? You will have a more joyful attitude when you acknowledge that there are others who are going through tougher times than you are. And I don't know about you, but it's healthy for me when I start to have a pity party for myself over something that I'm going through. It's healthy for me just to say, you know what? It could be worse. And those four magical words have a way of helping to bring me back to reality. It could be worse. So when you're tempted to say, hey, this isn't fair, or I'm so mad about this, I want you instead to say that phrase out loud. It could be worse. I want you to try it with me, okay? Right? One, two, three. And I want you to say that throughout this next week with whatever it is that you might be going through. So when this worship service is over and you go walking out to your car, and as you walk out to where your car is parked, you pass all these luxury cars and this nice sports car and this brand new SUV, and then you get to your car, right? You're going to be tempted to think, man, I just hope that this thing starts, right? But you're not going to think that today. Here's what you're going to think. You're going to think it could be worse. And after that, you're going to drive home after you eat some lunch today. And on your drive home, you're going to pass some really ritzy neighborhoods. And you're going to pass some nice mansions. And you're going to see some trendy condos. And then you're going to pull up at your shack, right? And you're going to get your door key out. And as you walk up to your door, you're going to want to say, man, if I lived in one of those big houses, I would be so happy. But you're not going to say that today. As you turn your key in, you're going to say, later today, you might do some manual labor. Maybe you'll go for a run. Maybe you will work out. Maybe you'll get sweaty from shoveling snow this evening. I don't know, right? But let's say you say, I've got to take a shower. And you go in and you shower up, and then as you get out of that shower, as you're reaching for your towel, accidentally you glance in the mirror and you see yourself in the side reflection. And in your mind, the guys are thinking, man, if I just worked out more, I'd have muscles like that guy at the gym. And the girls are thinking, oh, if I could have a body like that woman on Instagram, right? But you're not going to think those things. Instead, you're going to look yourself dead in the eye in the mirror, and you're going to say, tomorrow morning, when you wake up and you look across the pillow, no, no, no. Don't you dare say it. Don't blame it on the preacher, all right? No. You will get punched, all right? It's not worth it. Don't even think about it. That's where the illustration stops, all right? Whenever you play the comparison game, you will always come up wanting. Someone else's experience will always be a different one than yours. It may seem to go smoothly. It may be slow and frustrating. But remember, God is the one who gives the increase. And we don't know all that is taking place from what has been planted. Here's the last challenge. It's a third one. We'll write this down. Experience the growth. Experience the growth. Jesus is going to tell another brief parable, and this one is usually called the parable of the mustard seed. Look in your Bible at verse 30. And he said, with what can we compare the kingdom of God? Or what parable shall we use for it? It is like a grain of mustard seed, which when sown on the ground is the smallest of all the seeds on earth. Yet when it is sown, it grows up and becomes larger than all the garden plants and puts out large branches so that the birds of the air can make nests in its shade. The mustard seed in the first century was said to be the smallest seed around the area of Palestine, and yet somehow when God gets involved, something major happens and growth takes place. You see, that's the common thread between the two parables, growth. In the first story, God focuses on the process of the growth, right? In the second one, Jesus focuses on the contrast between the beginning and the end. Look at how dramatically things changed over a long period of time. You don't notice the mustard seed growing if you are watching it, but over time, eventually, you will be amazed at the massive size that it has become. And in this story, Jesus is saying the very same growth that takes place in a person's life is all the result of a very small seed being planted in faith. And God wants you to experience that faith. God wants you to experience that growth. And seated in every row, on every campus, are stories after stories of a parent, a coach, a godly grandmother, a teacher who planted a seed, and months and years and decades later, God has grown that seed and grown it into a massive tree that is bearing fruit. And when we follow those promptings of the Spirit and when we plant seeds, that is what we call evangelism. Evangelism is just a fancy word that means sharing the good news. Good news is at the heart of evangelism. It's just sharing good news with someone else about Jesus. And when you take the time to spiritually invest in non-believers and new Christians, when you invest that time in that person and help them grow, that's what we call discipleship. That's a fancy term for that. In either scenario, God can give the increase and that personal spiritual growth can take place. Here's a definition of discipleship from Greg Ogden. It says, discipleship is an intentional relationship in which we walk alongside others in order to encourage, equip, and challenge one another in love to grow toward maturity in Christ. So discipling is relational, it's personal, it's doing life together. It's both observing and teaching. Perhaps this will help you understand. Many of you are familiar with the Great Commission from Matthew chapter 28, verses 19 and 20. It's a passage of scripture that means a whole lot to us here at Harvest. It says, go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. Jesus is giving us our marching instructions. That passage could be divided up into four words. Go, teach, baptize, and then teach. Teaching doesn't stop at baptism. The teaching continues. It goes on and on. Back in 1850, there was a man by the name of Charles Adams, and he took that phrase from the Great Commission, where it says, making disciples, and he preached a sermon on that in 1850. And he talked about the first aspect, and he called that evangelism, the winning of the lost. And then the second aspect of making disciples was the maturing of the believers, and he called that discipleship. But once Charles Adams, 170 years ago, separated the two aspects in that sermon, something happened. Several Christian organizations began to prioritize either evangelism, while others prioritized discipleship. And that was unfortunate because they separated the two. And yet both are needed, and both are at the heart of Jesus' disciple-making model. Both aspects are inseparable. Proper evangelism cannot be done without discipled believers. And mature believers cannot be produced without the experience of evangelism, of someone coming to faith in Jesus Christ. Both sides of the coin are necessary. And as you study Jesus' life, you see both of these priorities lived out with an incredible balance, both evangelism and discipleship. And we also see it play out in the scripture. There's a verse that I love because it shows both of them. We'll keep it up for just a second. 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 8. We loved you so much, we were delighted to share with you not only the gospel of God, but our lives as well. Now look at that. Sharing the gospel of God. That's evangelism. Sharing our lives as well. That's discipleship. And when the two go hand in hand, we see and experience the growth. And seeds become trees. And lives are changed for all eternity. Some of you have just been playing at church. And you treat spiritual matters the same way I treated my daughter's field hockey games. And you're confused and you don't know what's going on, but you won't bother to go to the trouble to try to find out. And rather than diving in, you leave here more confused. Maybe it's time for you to choose to grow in this area, to choose that word surrender. Here's what I want you to go and tell this week. These parables teach us to never underestimate the potential and reach of God's kingdom, even when it seems unimpressive early on. God's kingdom will grow. There will be temporary setbacks. There will be opposition along the way. But may we continue to scatter seeds so that they can grow and so that we can grow into the image of Christ, our example, our Savior, our Lord. Let's pray. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, Lord, to the one who gives the growth to the source of life itself, we invite you, Lord, to do a work in our lives. We invite you to grow us, to sharpen us, to mature us. And Lord, may we be reaching out with an evangelistic heart, and may we be leaning in with the desire to be discipled by others and to bring someone else along as well. It's in the name of Jesus that we pray. Amen.